beautiful, aren't you? Of course you are. You're looking lovely today.
Did you know that some people talk to their plants and it seems to help? Or maybe people just think so. But today we're talking about the fact that many, many children in our world grow up with some pretty negative things being said to them. You're so stupid. You're ugly. You can't do it. I don't like you. And sadly, sometimes we keep all those messages stored up in our hearts and they get reactivated at times in our adulthood. As adults, we need to combat the negative things that have lodged in our hearts. What are the most encouraging words that you tend to hear? How about these ones? You're valuable. You are a beautiful person. Well, that was just what I needed to hear. I think of you so often. You look lovely today. That was an excellent point. What a good job you've done on that. I can't wait to see you again. This is tough, but you are tougher. Rick says, today an encouraging message that sometimes the second fiddle plays the sweetest music. That's clear in the life of first century missionary Barnabas, who's often overshadowed by the Apostle Paul. The core message from Barnabas is that real faith and maturity are about going first, not coming first. So as we begin a time of worship together, I want to remind you that worship shouldn't be something that we watch, but that we participate in. All of the things that we do when we hear songs and scriptures and teaching that confirms what's written in the scripture deserve a little affirmation. And that can be anything from nodding your head to clapping your hands to commenting out loud. Back in Chronicles 16, David and the Israelites were celebrating the return of the Ark of the Covenant, and they sang a song of praise to God. And scripture says, then all of the people said, amen, and praise the Lord. Amen just means surely, truly, or so be it. So let's amen our worship today, encouraging each other, affirming God's greatness.
One, two, three, four. You are not alone if you are lonely. When you feel afraid, you're not the only. We are all the same in need of mercy.
One of the ways we encourage each other is in constant reminders of the fact that this world isn't it. There is a far, far better place awaiting us on the other side of death.
Yes.
Words are great bits of affirmation, aren't they? But the best encouragement in the world includes actions. And that's why I love this song by Matthew West that encourages us to do something.
I woke this morning. Saw a world full of trouble now. Thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you. Now listen. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. Well, it's time for us to do something. Yeah. If not now, then when will we see an end to all this pain? Well, it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do something. Talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. Live like angels of apathy, we'll tell ourselves it's alright, somebody else will do something.
About encouragement, it often comes down to reminding others and ourselves about the fact that today, this situation, this problem, this hour, the world does not have power over us. Our comfort and our assurance of the future is found in our God.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine.
conscious of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from His love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though He was God, He did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, He gave up His divine privileges, He took the humble position of a slave, and was born as a human being. When He appeared in human form, He humbled Himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated Him to the place of highest honor and gave Him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him.
Lord, we come to you admitting that each of us has failed to be the encouragers we should be. All too often, we focus on the negatives that we see and hear all around us, and we don't notice the positive qualities of both people and the situations we find ourselves in. Forgive us about our wrong thinking and wash away those negative thoughts and skepticism that sometimes become habit. Lord, stop us from jumping to judgment. Give us balance and wisdom in our observations of those around us and every situation we face. There are so many people who are angry and discouraged these days. Help us to intervene in their anger and lift them up with encouraging words and actions. Remind each of us that the things we need, affirmation, appreciation, encouragement, and unconditional love, are also the things that all others need. And most especially, help us to offer your love to people every single day and your word of encouragement, Jesus Christ. It's in His name we pray. Amen.
My mom used to tell me that hearing their own name was music to a person's ears. Of course, she kind of ruined that thought for me when she used to triple name me whenever I was in trouble. If you've seen the lovely movie The Help, which is set in the 1960s, you know there's a black nanny who whispers some special words every day to the little white girl in her charge. She says, "You is kind, you is smart, you is important." Such affirming words. Can you imagine if you had grown up hearing those words every single day? God's words of affirmation about you are in the scripture. You can turn to them every single day. Write them on your heart and make them a concrete part of who you are. Here's what He says. Don't be afraid. I am with you. The peace of God will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Be strong and courageous. The Lord is with you wherever you go. I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. All things work out for those who love the Lord. You'll have tribulation in this world, but take heart. I have overcome the world. What would your life be like if you listened to those words every day of your life? And more than words, our God offered action. He put His Son where His words were, sending Jesus to die for you. Those words, "It is finished," are the most powerful words of love and encouragement that we have. Jesus completed the task and offered salvation to all the world. After such encouragement, how can we not express our gratitude each week? If you have communion emblems, let's bless them. Father, we ask that you are with us today and that you accept our gratitude and praise. For those who have the blessing of the emblems in front of them, a bit of juice, a bit of wine, I ask that you bless those things and help us to take them, remembering what you have done for us, remembering your broken body, remembering the blood that was shed for us. We say thank you. Amen.
To see things like you do, God, I'll sing it one more time, just the voices. And hallelujah, our God reigns.
I hope you've heard some words of encouragement today and been inspired to work at being an encourager to those around you this week. Here's some more inspiration for the journey. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. That's from Isaiah 40, verse 31. Go out and be an encourager this week, and may God bless you. And now here's Rick with his visual sermon.
History is filled with people and events who were largely overshadowed by other people and events. Harriet Quimby was one of the first women to get a pilot's license and the first woman to fly across the English Channel, but she never got her moment in the sun. Soon after she landed in France, the Titanic went down, killing 1,500 people. So few heard about Quimby's achievement, and she died in an airplane accident a couple of months later. Likewise, in 1963, monumental writers C.S. Lewis and Aldous Huxley died on the same day, but the world hardly took notice, because that was the day President John Kennedy was assassinated. In 1996, the same thing happened again, with the death of Mother Teresa, who dedicated her life to serving the poor. Though she was revered by many, her legacy was completely overshadowed by the massive outpouring of grief over the death of 36-year-old Princess Diana just a few days later. In much the same way, the amazing contribution of the Apostle Barnabas in the New Testament goes largely unnoticed because most of the focus is on his contemporary, the Apostle Paul. Yet it could be argued that Barnabas was a man of exceptional faith and service, and that Paul couldn't have done what he did without his help. So today we're going to look at the legacy of Barnabas and what he can teach us about how to play the second fiddle like a virtuoso. The future apostle was born into a Jewish family on the island of Cyprus and given the name Joses or Joseph. But the early Christians gave him the nickname Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. And that he was. Soon after the resurrection of Jesus, Barnabas became one of his first followers in the city of Jerusalem. We're introduced to him in Acts 4, where we're told, all the believers were of one heart and mind. They felt what they owned was not theirs, so they shared it. The apostles spoke powerfully of the resurrection, and God's great blessing was upon them all. No one was needy, because those who owned land or houses sold them and the money was given to the poor. For instance, Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, sold a field and took the money to the apostles. Barnabas did exactly what Jesus told the rich young ruler to do in Matthew 19. Go, sell all your possessions and give to the poor, the Lord says, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. That was and still is a radical notion, but it energized the early church. Now look. The Bible does not say we have to sell all our stuff and give the money to the poor. But it does say we have to give sacrificially to those in need, whether it's our time, energy, or money. And the very fact Barnabas was willing to sell his land tells us volumes about his faith and character, because what he did was unthinkable to the Jews of his day. You just didn't sell land because it was normally passed down through your family and you were expected to give it to your children when the time came. land was sacred. But that was before Barnabas heard about the resurrection, before he saw the apostles healing people, and before the people in his tiny church started to starve because they'd rather lose their jobs than keep their mouths shut about Jesus. But the land gesture was just an extension of the man's character. In Acts 11, we're told, Barnabas was good, full of the Holy Spirit, and strong in faith. Wouldn't you like to be remembered like that?
-1.
When persecution swept Jerusalem, the Christians scattered, and Barnabas was a valuable resource. He was a well-traveled foreigner who knew his way around. The book of Acts says some Christians went to Cyprus, the home of Barnabas, and others went to Antioch, preaching about Jesus. The power of the Lord was with them, and many, many Gentiles believed and turned to the Lord. So the Jerusalem church sent Barnabas to Antioch. We're told, when he saw the evidence of God's blessing, he was filled with joy, and he encouraged the believers to stay true to the Lord. And many were brought to Jesus. For a very long time, Antioch was the second most important city for the entire church, right after Jerusalem. It was a power center that sent out missionaries and helped establish church doctrine, and Barnabas was front and center. He helped establish that church, and he did it not by command and control, but by courage and encouragement. Though there's no explanation, Acts 11 also says Barnabas went to the Turkish city of Tarsus looking for a man named Saul. He took Saul back to Antioch, and they worked together for a year teaching large crowds. And it was at Antioch that believers were first called Christians, or followers of Christ. Going to find Saul, who would later become the Apostle Paul, was insane. For years, Saul had terrorized the early church, throwing Christians into prison and standing by while martyrs like Stephen were executed. One day, on his way to Damascus, Syria, Saul is blinded by a light, and Jesus appears to ask why Saul is persecuting him. Almost immediately, Saul has a change of heart and begins to preach for Jesus. But of course, nobody trusts him. Nobody except Barnabas. Barnabas takes Saul to the apostles and vouches for him, putting all his credibility and reputation on the line. As Luke writes, they were all afraid of Saul, not believing he really was a disciple. But Barnabas convinces them Saul's faith is real. And Acts says, with the encouragement of the Holy Spirit, the church grew in numbers. There's that word again, encouragement, by both Barnabas and the Holy Spirit. So the big lesson for us is that we need to believe in people. We need to see the best in them and be willing to take a chance on them. After all, so many people live up to the expectations of others. So we can play a pivotal role by offering not just full forgiveness, but also trust and confidence. After all, that's what God does for us. So be like Barnabas. Stand up for people and stand with them. That's exactly what the word encouragement means. To stand alongside someone. Barnabas does that not only for Saul, later named Paul, but also for a young man named John Mark, who was either his cousin or nephew. The language isn't exactly clear. For at least a year, Barnabas and Paul made an extensive missionary journey, which included covering the whole island of Cyprus, where Barnabas was born. Mark was their assistant. Though we're not told why, Mark bails on Paul and Barnabas. Maybe he was homesick, or perhaps it was the constant threat of violence against the group. Anyway, he's out of there. And then the church in Antioch wants to send Paul and Barnabas on a second missionary trip. Barnabas wants to take Mark, but Paul refuses. Ironic, isn't it? Barnabas vouches for Paul, but Paul refuses to extend the same grace to Mark. Things got so bad the two men had to go their separate ways on separate trips, and Barnabas took Mark. That begs the question, who in your life needs someone to vouch for them after past failure? Despite the falling out, Barnabas had a huge influence on Paul, who went on to write half the books of the New Testament, and on Mark too, who wrote the gospel bearing his name. Without that influence, who knows what would have happened to either man and the church? We owe a lot to Barnabas. By the way, there's a document called The Gospel of Barnabas, which is 222 chapters long. It contains lots of details found in the New Testament Gospels, but it's vastly different. The book, written on animal skins, denies Jesus was divine and says Judas was crucified, not Jesus. It was written during medieval times, and no serious scholar believes it came from Barnabas. Along with character and conviction, Barnabas is known for clarity, his clear sense of identity, purpose, and place. And in that regard, he's so unlike most of us. When he first starts out, Barnabas is in the lead role, and Paul is widely seen as his apprentice. We know that because in the New Testament, the order names are placed in reveals their relative importance, and Barnabas is always mentioned first, at least in the beginning. And in Acts 14, during a visit to what's now Turkey, the people are so impressed with Barnabas, they think he's Zeus, the greatest Greek god of all, and that Paul is Hermes, his messenger. But later, perceptions change. In the last part of their time together, the book of Acts talks about Paul and Barnabas with a reversal of the earlier order. Paul is seen as the most important one. But Barnabas didn't need to compare himself. He knew he was a child of God, loved and empowered by the Holy Spirit to serve his purpose. It needs to be the same with us. Envy is alive and well in the church. Like most other people, a lot of us endlessly compare ourselves to one another in terms of ability, credit, reputation, and popularity. And that's dangerous. It makes us oblivious and dissatisfied with the blessings we have. We get jealous of others, and we're unable to focus on the things that matter most, like honoring God and one another, even when others eclipse us. In 2 Corinthians 10:12, Paul condemns some Christian leaders. They're only comparing themselves with each other, he says, using themselves as the standard of measurement. How ignorant! If you want to boast, boast only about the Lord. And earlier he says, love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It doesn't demand its own way. It's not irritable. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Barnabas could have written that. And that's how God wants us to react when others are in the spotlight, whether they deserve it or not. We need to be bridge builders like Barnabas, who reached out to the poor by selling his land, to Paul by putting his cred on the line, to Mark, despite the man's track record, and to the Gentiles, who were met with suspicion and racism when they first came into the church. To be the same, we will need to focus on our humility, not our ability.
The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples, When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God."
As John the Baptist told his disciples about Jesus, "I am filled with joy at his success. He must become greater and greater, and I must become less and less." That's the Barnabas way. Throughout his life, Barnabas traveled the world, talking about Jesus and the resurrection, establishing churches, and encouraging believers wherever he found them. Like Paul, he suffered poverty, deprivation, and outright persecution, but he never shut up and he never gave up, no matter how tough the opposition. In the centuries after Barnabas died, a monastery was built in his name in his hometown of Salamis, Cyprus, overtop a tomb said to hold his remains. It is said that Barnabas was attacked while preaching one day, dragged into the street, beaten, and then set afire. He lived and died without compromising his convictions. May the same be said of us. "Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life," says Jesus in Revelation 2:10. But we have trouble being faithful even to the point of getting out of bed for worship. Real faithfulness is having Barnabas's character, conviction, clarity, and courage. So, stand out. Be a good person, full of the Holy Spirit and strong in faith. Use what you have to honor God, your money, time, energy, and life. Stand up. See the best in others, vouch for them, and support them. But also know when to stand down. Recognize that disputes are inevitable, but don't let them discourage you. Be calm and humble, and know who you are in the eyes of God. Then you won't need the spotlight or comparison with anybody else. And stand fast. Have the courage of your convictions, even when it comes with a price, knowing God will reward your faithfulness. In a nutshell, serve wherever, whenever, and however you can, without concern for credit or approval. If you have to play second fiddle, do it without strings attached.